I want to be sure that any parents who are watching the program hear your words very closely, what you just said, because your assessment of these kids is something that's occurring 6 months out. It's not like the week after they're discharged from the ICU to expect everything's going to go back to the way it was, and that it looks like this is a bit of a long-term kind of recovery. Hello, everyone. I'm Dr. David Perlmutter. Welcome again to the program. There's no question that children seem to be doing pretty well when it relates to COVID-19 infection, COVID-19 clinical manifestations. They do pretty well. Their immune system seem to be robust, but occasionally they do have a complication, this multisystem inflammatory syndrome. That is rare, no question it is rare, but they can have this issue, which can be quite aggressive. And one of the complications of this syndrome that kids can get can be the involvement of the brain and even the peripheral nervous system. So we're going to interview today two experts in the neurologic consequences of this syndrome. Let me tell you a little bit about our guests. Dr. Omar Abdelmanan is a senior pediatric neurology registrar, a resident, at Great Ormond Street Hospital for Children, currently undertaking a PhD at UCL Institute of Neurology, funded by the Association of British Neurologists and the MS Multiple Sclerosis Society. After completing his undergraduate degree, medical degree, at Oxford University in 2011, he completed general pediatrics training, securing research funding as an NIHR Academic Clinical Fellow in pediatrics between 2013 and 17, at UCL Institute of Child Health, followed by a Guarantors of Brain Clinical Entry Fellowship between 2020 and 21 at UCL Institute of Neurology. His current PhD project and research interest is focused on pediatric multiple sclerosis and what are called demyelinating conditions of children. Our other guest is Dr. Yael Hacohen. She is an MD, PhD. She is a consultant pediatric neurologist at Great Ormond Street Hospital for Children and UCL Institute of Neurology in London. She completed her doctoral studies in 2014 in the Newfield Department of Clinical Neuroscience at Oxford University, where she studied children with autoimmune encephalitis and characterized their clinical as well as immunological phenotypes. In 2014, she was awarded the Dupré Grant by the Multiple Sclerosis International Federation for a Research Fellowship at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia, and her research output has resulted in over 70 peer-reviewed publications. It is noted that she lectures frequently, nationally and internationally. Her main research interest at this time and her expertise is in what is called neuroimmunology, particularly the role of antibodies in pediatric acquired demyelinating syndromes. And we'll certainly talk about what that means and then, of course, have a discussion as relates to the topic of the day. So let's get right to our interview. Hello, doctors. Welcome to the program. I'd like to start, if we could, with Dr. Hacohen. And we're going to go back a ways, first of all. We're going to cover the study that appeared in JAMA Network. But if you could first tell us, how common is this multisystem inflammatory syndrome that children are experiencing? We know that it's rare. How common is this situation?
So it's extremely rare, considering what we think was the prevalence of COVID in general in children. So for an example, I mean, it's probably less than 1% of children that had COVID would have this. We had about 200 children in London over the last year with this condition, and maybe something like 400 children in the UK in general.
So that's just the entire syndrome, not necessarily the neurological
Correct.
Involvement. In the article, perhaps Omar, you could address this. In the article that you both put out back in JAMA Network, July of 2020, I think your numbers were a bit different in terms of what you discovered in comparison to the more recent study. Let's go back, if we can, to that first study. And why do you suppose that the incidence of neurologic involvement was so different back then in comparison to the newer study?
So I think the difficulty is we're dealing with small numbers, as Yao sort of alluded to. So even in the first wave of patients that we had at Grey Ormond Street in our center, we had 46 patients in total. And across the London network, it was, as we said, a few hundreds, and across the UK, 300, 400. So I think retrospectively, we're going back and looking at the numbers with a larger cohort. We picked up some neurological abnormalities that maybe were not seen initially. But I think the range of neurological presentations across the literature and in newer studies as well, for example, the American recent multi-center study, I think with 600 patients, has reported quite similar numbers. So there is a bit of variety because of the rarity of the condition, but it does range around the sort of, you know, anything between the 10 to 50% mark, essentially.
So Omar, again, to you, what is it about your interest has been demyelinative and autoimmune kinds of conditions in the pediatric population, things like MS, for example? How does that kind of pave the way then for your interest and research then as it relates to how children may be responding to COVID infection?
So I think the first of all, you know, the way I was involved in this was actually because the restructuring of the hospital during the time of the pandemic. So we ended up looking a lot of after a lot of general pediatric patients and lots of other specialties. And part of that was a PIMS-TS or multisystem inflammatory syndrome ward with the patients coming in. So I had involvement with those patients from early on. But I think there's definitely some similarities between some of the demyelinating conditions or neuroinflammatory conditions that myself and Dr. Hackman deal with compared to this. So we alluded to in the JAMA Neurology paper and kind of more recently in this update that there's definite overlap with conditions such as hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis or HLH with the cytokine storm and the sort of central and peripheral nervous system involvement happening simultaneously in children, which we rarely see in pediatric neurology. So there's a definite overlap there.
So Dr. Hakoan, what are some of the neurological consequences that you're seeing and that have developed? And then I'd like to talk about perhaps speculation in terms of those mechanisms. But first, what are some of the things that these children are demonstrating?
So what was very striking is that we very rarely see children that present both the central nervous system presentation and peripheral nervous system presentation, with the exception, you see it sometimes in adults with some of the paraneoplastic condition, you know, when people have a tumor and their immune system start attacking everywhere. We would see it sometimes in some of the oncology patients on treatment. They get treatment, but again, you can get a presentation of both central nervous system and peripheral nervous system. But overall, it's incredibly rare in children to see that. And initially, when we were seeing all these kids, and bear in mind in the setup of a pandemic, and those kids were quite sick, they were in the intensive care. So it took us a while to actually pull the whole things together, because we didn't know, is the encephalopathy from the medication they're on? Is the peripheral neuropathy from an ITU neuropathy? So that's why perhaps there have been some of the underdiagnosis of some of the patients initially in the first cohort, whereas in the larger cohort, we were maybe as clinician at time be better at picking it up than we did in the first cohort. I think that, you know, when talking mechanistically, and that's very important in terms of management and treatment, particularly when we live in an era that with a lot of monoclonal antibodies that target very specific pathways when you use all those medications. So the general feeling with these patients is that it's more of a cytokine release. So, you know, Omar and I work with children with autoimmune encephalitis and children with MS. They all use many medications that target B cells or T cells. So it's important to know what we think the mechanism is when we decide on treatment and management.
You think that some of the clinical manifestations, or perhaps most of them, are a consequence of the cytokines of the hyperinflammatory response.
State. Exactly. And what was interesting is that when we did, again, the numbers are small, but the overall feeling is that if the systemic inflammation was very severe, then these kids were more likely to have neurological symptoms than children that the systemic inflammation wasn't. The caveat of that is that we've also seen a number of children over the last year that are not included in this study that had similar neurological presentation, i.e. central nervous system, peripheral nervous system, sometimes this splenial lesion that is, again, very rare in children, we don't see it often, in the absence of any systemic inflammation. So there's perhaps another subgroup that we haven't reported that may present with neurological symptoms only in the absence of any systemic inflammation.
So were you able then to correlate any inflammatory markers with the development of these neurological manifestations?
Statistically, yes, but again, the numbers. So inflammatory markers had a odds ratio higher to develop the neurological symptoms. But again, the numbers are small, so I don't think we can definitely say more about it.
You mentioned these splenial lesions, and just for our viewers, we're talking about a lesion that's in the back part of the corpus callosum. The corpus callosum being this major white matter tract that connects the hemispheres. It's the largest white matter tract in the brain. Any sense, first of all, as to why, Omar, if we could go to you, why the splenium of the corpus callosum might be involved? And then beyond that, what might some of the clinical manifestations be of a lesion in the back part of the corpus callosum?
Well, I think the first thing to say is that although very rare, and these tend to be reversible lesions that disappear actually when you repeat imaging, it has been described in other infections in the literature. So we've seen it in influenza, in mumps, in Coxsackie virus, but also interestingly in some isolated case reports of Kawasaki disease, which has a lot of phenotypic overlap with PIMS-TS. The initial descriptions were Kawasaki-like disease. So it's not pathognomonic, or it's definitely not sort of distinctive to PIMS, but it was just a very interesting observation that we kept seeing this lesion appear in these patients and again would disappear further down the line.
And the interesting point was that although it's been reported in the literature, I think in our institute there's a big pediatric neurology center. We haven't seen it for about 5 years, and suddenly we saw 10 of them. So you know, I think that was one of the striking things that made us kind of put perhaps the first report together, thinking this is quite an unusual constellation of neurological and radiological features that, although have all in isolation been reported with other things, we're suddenly seeing them quite frequently.
This lesion of the splenium of the corpus callosum, though it was common, is not going to be pathognomonic of neurological involvement with this syndrome, especially since it seems to resolve.
I think if you would see it now in a child, considering it, as I said, it's quite rare in children, if you would see it now in close proximity to COVID, I think one would assume it's related to that, and it perhaps would stop you from trying to find other causes of this.
Mm-hmm. Let me get Yael back to you. The peripheral neuropathic issues that you are seeing, are these demyelinative?
Unfortunately, in the majority of the children, they're axonal. So they tend to, if anything, the children that had an axonal neuropathy were the bit of the group that has done the worst.
So maybe you could explain for our viewers what is the difference in terms of the implication of a demyelinated versus an axonal damage.
So if when we see demyelinating neuropathy, these are the neuropathies that are more likely to respond to treatment. More likely to be reversible, whereas if the axon is involved, then it seems to be more permanent. The other type of neuropathy that we've seen is a small fiber neuropathy that was presumed to be, again, secondary to the systemic inflammation. And these are the type of neuropathy that you diagnose clinically, because electrodiagnostics are not going to pick them up. And the children, you know, you're not going to start doing biopsies on these nerves. But clinically, many of the children had a small fiber neuropathy.
What I believe you're saying is, unlike, for example, Guillain-Barré type of demyelinative neuropathy that you might see in conjunction with or after a viral illness, this is a more destructive type of damage to the nerve cell in these children.
Correct. And I think if you look at the COVID literature, there has been, and we've seen a number of children that presented with post-COVID Guillain-Barré syndrome, but I think you know, these kind of neuroimmune condition, whether they're affecting the central nervous system or the peripheral nervous system, we see every year following infection. Sometimes there's a link between the specific infection and the immune-mediated mechanism after. So there's a number, you know, Guillain-Barré is the classic one when you get Campylobacter followed by an axonal motor neuropathy. Similarly, you know, there's been other links, for example, herpes virus in the brain can lead to NMDA encephalitis, again, very, viral and immune specific. But I think what we've seen with COVID is that you have an infection and you see multiple mechanisms of post-infectious immunological condition, whether they are neurological one or whether they're systemic one. We happen to see the neurological one, so I can comment on them a bit better. But I think that the point is that it's very important to do all your diagnostic to figure out what's the exact mechanism. And I think the other thing is that actually, if we look at numbers, if anything, the feeling is that perhaps we've seen slightly less neuroimmune cases this year because of isolation and mask and everything. So, and every infection we've seen have been, you know, a post-infection syndrome, have been post-COVID. So we've been, you know, seeing all these COVID cases, but we actually haven't seen other things.
It's amazing what some behavioral changes will do. I mean, you know, with relation to other types of infection.
Yeah. So I think it's I would say beyond this clinical presentation of those children with a multisystic inflammatory syndrome, there is a new syndrome. I think the rest of the association that we've seen in COVID pretty similar to what we see every year in our neuroimmune immunology clinic, whether it's autoimmune encephalitis, whether it's GBS, whether it's ADEM, and we've been managing them exactly the same. So I think it's also important not to call everything a post-COVID thing and just go back to your basic, bear in mind that this is really the only infection we've seen this year.
I was just going to say one other thing kind of on that theme is actually with the PIMS-TS or the MISC in the States. Because there's such a sort of, you know, a number of cases coming into our intensive care, there's a worry sometimes that it sometimes gets overcalled, and there was actual cases of sometimes missing a diagnosis, which presented, you know, with raised inflammatory markers and so on. So I think it's really important for pediatricians as well to just be aware, you know, of the common things, and just not to miss those when we're sort of diagnosing PIMS-TS cases as well.
In particular, malignancy, if you see a sick child with raised inflammatory syndromes, you know, it's your bread and butter pediatrics, you need to rule out malignancies. And I think because PIMS-TS have been quite common this winter, there's been easily been labeled. So I think we really need to go back to our diagnostic skill and make sure that we're making the diagnosis. And this is really a diagnosis of exclusion, particularly when COVID is so common.
It seemed that a lot of these kids had EEG slowing. And what would this be an indication of? Just diffuse brain involvement or a response to elevated cytokines?
I think it's hard to know exactly what's the mechanism that caused this, whether they had an encephalopathy as part of the syndrome or whether it's the cytokines or whether it's, you know, many of them were in intensive care. So it's also, you know, would probably contribute to that. What was very interesting is that quite a lot of them prior to even coming to hospital were a bit confused and had hallucinations. So I know that it was something that people were asking us when we reported the hallucinations. Was this because of steroids? Was this because, you know, they were scared in the intensive care? And we went back to many of these kids when we followed them up in clinic, and the parents and the children clearly described exactly what they were seeing. So they had very striking visual hallucination that preceded even coming to hospital.
So again, this would not be a steroid related type of event, in your opinion.
Pre-medication, pre-treatment. Mm-hmm. And very vivid, as Dr. Akin describes, a child describing to me sort of cartoons of Donald Duck and the little duckling sort of moving on the wall, or people not being in the room. So that's something that we screen when we're asking all their children now, kind of after the event, after they've come after the intensive care, we always ask them about hallucinations as part of the symptoms.
And by and large, what can you say about how these kids are doing, Omar?
So we sort of have 6 months follow-up now from the first wave, at least the 46 patients. And the majority of those children have made an almost complete recovery from a functional point of view. Some of the neurological abnormalities that we're still seeing are quite subtle examination findings that we as neurologists would pick up, such as dysmetria or difficulty with tandem walking that you may not pick up otherwise. But I think that the two aspects which we've noticed, and they're really outside of the neurological spectrum, is from a physiotherapy point of view, a lot of these children, A, because they've been in intensive care, and B, because of lockdown and disuse of their muscles, actually have quite a lot of proximal myopathy. They're not sort of as quick or as able to do their exercises as they did before. And the other thing we noticed was a lot of emotional lability, with children describing periods of frustration followed by periods of being very emotional. And again, it's difficult to know whether that's you know, purely the disease itself or a combination of everything that's going on. And we know that in the adult literature, at least on large scale sort of studies, that there's definite neuropsychiatric sort of manifestations even further down the line. So that's something that...
Which might be far more pervasive than just these children that you have the opportunity to evaluate.
Yeah, I'm sure we see it across all spectrum of, you know, healthy children and children without a medical condition. But I think the one very striking thing, if you look at groups of children that needed intensive care admission, which was the majority of this group, they've done amazingly. They've done so well at 6 months. So I think despite the fact that we, of course, have some concerns and we've noticed some difficulties, that I feel that because it's things like physiotherapy and psychological support is things that we can actually intervene and help, overall as a group they've done very well.
Well, I want to be sure that any parents who are watching the program hear your words very closely, what you just said, because your assessment of these kids is something that's occurring 6 months out. It's not like the week after they're discharged from the ICU to expect everything's going to go back to the way it was. And that it looks like this is a bit of a long-term kind of recovery.
So I think the recovery, you know, even at 6 weeks, they're very well. So I think at 6 months, they're all back in school, which is you know, great. It's difficult to comment really on timing when the normal life has been interrupted so much. So what I can tell you is that if the same child would have had to actually physically walk to school and do his homework and do everything normally, I'm actually not sure whether actually the recovery would have been faster. But sometimes difficult if a child spent a couple of weeks in hospital and they come home and they basically wake up in the morning, sit on a chair, do Zoom schooling and everything and continue with the days, then you get much more deconditioning than you would normally. And of course, you would be vulnerable after intensive care. Anybody would, the family, their children. And with everything else that is going on, you know, that can also... for sure doesn't help the anxiety.
Despite the deconditioning and the lack of activity, both in the ICU and just in general because of the changes in society, is there any evidence that there's any inflammatory muscle issue that may be happening in the background?
No.
Okay.
And there's actually all the inflammatory markers reverse very quickly. So when you, even at 6 weeks, the inflammatory markers go back to baseline.
All right, that's the same for the other systems. So because we've been focusing on the neurology, but these children, when they come in, will often have cardiac markers that are highly elevated or gastroenterological issues as well. So all those systems by 6 weeks and 6 months definitely will have pretty much resolved. So I think the one other observation is that some of the children that were more active in terms of the ones doing more competitive or even elite sports and so on, those ones... And this is more anecdotal, but the physiotherapists, in fact, and us noticed that those children tend to get back to their baseline quicker, sort of after the discharge from hospital.
Well, that's an interesting observation, anecdotal though it may be, because, you know, we know on the broader scale that people who had a more healthy lifestyle pre-COVID and therefore lower risk for development of the conditions like hypertension, type 2 diabetes, obesity, et cetera, those individuals seem to do better. And I think that what we're seeing is a lot of it has to do with immunosenescence, the ability, you know, the aging of our immune cells versus their ability to respond appropriately.
But that would be, I think, a bit different, because if anything, these kids have an overactive immune system. So, I mean, I think the immunosenescence probably apply much more to the elderly population and not really to children, because I wouldn't expect the immune system to have been modified by this or to have changed that much, in, you know, considering all of them are young.
That's for sure. What, in light of your sense that, you know, most of what's going on is a consequence of the inflammation, what do you recommend then for intensivists, pediatric intensivists, in terms of what they should be considering based upon this presumed mechanism in terms of how they would interface with a pediatric patient?
I mean, I actually think that there's been a tremendous effort to do trials and nationally and multinationally. And I've, you know, it's pretty amazing what they've managed to achieve that quickly with recruiting most children suffering from this condition into trials very, very quickly. I think within a month of this condition being recognized. So there's been a number of trials. Some of them use steroids, some use IVIG, some use tocilizumab, which is an IL-6, which is specifically targeting the cytokine pathway. I don't know what the results of the trial would show, and that would be an interesting to know. It seems that most kids actually haven't received tocilizumab, have received steroids and have done very well. Steroids is just a general broad spectrum. So I mean, I wouldn't be able to comment based on what we know now, whether the management should be changed. I think just from the key observation is that actually we need to make sure that we're excluding mimics, because that's been a bit of a worry recently with everything being labeled as this. More than anything else. And I think also with neurological problems, you know, if we had a patient with a limb encephalitis that, you know, was thought to have PIMS. So I think even from a neurological point of view, it's back to your clinical examination and investigation to make sure that you're making the right diagnosis.
Are kids as involved with loss of sense of smell and taste as we're hearing with adults?
I think the numbers are a bit small, but we also have seen it. I think the loss of smell and taste is thought to be more of an acute viral injury, whereas the children normally present not from the acute virus, but by the post. So most kids that we see probably present about 2 months after their parents had COVID, or a month after their parents had COVID, so not straight away after. So they have a COVID contact, but people in the house have been sick, and then a month or so later, they have this.
And actually, only about a quarter of them were PCR positive, and the diagnostic criteria relies on them having antibodies. So, as Yael said, it's events, or it happens a few weeks after they've probably been exposed to the virus, or months even.
Let me push a little further beyond your publication and your poster presentation, and just ask either of you to comment on perhaps safety and efficacy of immunizations in the pediatric population. At least, what is the discussion where you guys are?
I mean, we actually neurologists, so it's mainly the infectious disease people that deal with that. I don't think we can really comment. I know that the trials have started in children in the UK, and it'd be interesting to see the results. We, of course, have to kind of try to prioritize some of our, you know, patients on immunosuppression and stuff. And a lot of our work, you know, we see MS kids, so we need to make decisions on timing of when they should get the vaccination in relation to their medication to make sure that they get the most.
Well, I think the take-home message then is that this seems pretty much to be self-limited. That is, it is exceedingly rare, that even the syndrome itself is pretty darn rare, and the neurologic complications are even quite much rarer, but parents should be encouraged that things are going to improve with time. So all in all, very good news.
I think the one the one thing just to say is that, you know, these children, when they're sick, they're really initially very sick and need a really intensive sort of care from, you know, from all sorts of specialties. So it's really important as well, you know, for both parents and pediatricians who see them at the first line, if they're concerned, to refer early as well. So I think that's an important thing. And that's probably why we've got such low mortality rates, and because of the quality of sort of intensive care management they're getting, and then all the specialties that are involved.
Then the MDT, I mean, we've been seeing all of these kids as part of an MDT assessment. So with us, there were infectious disease doctor, cardiologist, gastroenterologist, the ENT specialist, physio, psychology. So everybody was seeing the kids at the same time. So actually just learning from the group was probably the most important thing, both for us and for the patient.
Yeah, that's not something that typically would happen perhaps in a community hospital setting. So that's a point well taken. The other point that you made, I think, is really very valuable, is that you still need to do the work in terms of ruling out the other things that we've all been trained to look for that kids can develop anyway, and not just say, well, this is a consequence of COVID, multisystem inflammatory syndrome, and that you made this point. We really have to remember that they can get, my dad used to tell me, a man can get as many diseases as he damn well pleases. So, you know, I think we have to keep an eye out for the other things that can still happen during the time of COVID.
Yeah.
Let me thank you both for spending time with us today on the program. You're doing great work. And I think for all the rest of us out in the field, you know, what you've uncovered is very encouraging. And I think it really provides us a good mechanistic understanding as to what's going on with these children. So I want to thank you for spending time with us today.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for having us.
Well, it certainly was an interesting interview. I mean, these researchers are doing an incredible job in trying to deconstruct exactly what's going on in children when not only they have this syndrome, but perhaps what their interest is, more importantly, what is the involvement of the brain, why does it happen, how does it happen, and how it may manifest itself clinically. I'm very appreciative that they took the time to join us today and that you could join us and watch the program as well. I'm Dr. David Perlmutter. We will be back soon. Bye for now.